Right then. Big subject to cover, lots of areas. I'm sure lots of people here have lots of input to partake also. And what I want you all to feel is that it's fully inclusive here. Any point anybody wants to speak, please do. But we're not going to, you know, keep you bursting with questions to the last minute, because very often, if there's a pertinent question at a specific time, then it helps to keep the whole thing rolling. Okay? Right, so Hector and myself were from, and Sara are from the Genetic Engineering Network, and we've been going for nearly 20 years now, so we're one of the longest running groups on this issue. And currently, my major concern currently that I've been working on, I do run a Twitter site, so I'm a busy bloke on a regular basis, but I've been concentrating on glyphosate and Roundup, as you probably are aware of it, horrible stuff, an endocrine disrupting chemical, and one that if there's any justice in the world and any reasonable law and respect for environmental articles and stuff like that, it would have been banned years ago. But we're faced with a situation where we're being pressed to approve commercial releases of GM crops, many of which, the majority of which, will be herbicide tolerant to glyphosate. Okay? Now, until recently, what I used to do was I used to make the comparison of what is going on in the USA, where they've had commercial releases of GM crops for 20 years now, as opposed to ourselves here. Now, in the US, for instance, currently, there has been a 13-fold increase, 1,300% increase since 1996, when the first herbicide tolerated crops for soya and maize were introduced into the US. Currently, the level of glyphosate in the populace in the USA is 10-fold what it is currently in the UK. So straight away we can make the comparison then. Well, if we have what the USA has had for the last 20 years, we're going down exactly the same road. So now you might be wondering that, well, we're okay at the moment because we don't have herbicide-tolerant GM crops, so we don't have Roundup inside of us. Unfortunately, that's not the case. We all have Roundup in our bodies, and it is bioaccumulating inside of us, and no one anywhere in the world knows anything about the long-term effects of that. Okay? So when people tell you that these crops are safe, they are lying, or they're very misinformed. Okay? So, and if any, I don't mean to be disrespectful to any biotech scientists that might be sitting in front of me, but we can certainly talk about it afterwards if you want to, all right? Now, last year, a couple of years ago, a group in America, some moms in America, were really concerned about the levels of glyphosate in the atmosphere. So a group of moms across the States were tested for glyphosate, lactating mothers, and it was fairly freaky what happened. One lady had 1,200 times the European safe water maximum level of glyphosate in her breast milk. Right? Now, this is a bit freaky. I don't mean to, you know, want to frighten young mothers, and we all have family, and we all are concerned about these issues, right? So, now, to the UK, where is glyphosate coming from if it's not being sprayed by all the farmers everywhere, as in America? It's coming from your local authority, who are spraying it all around the schools and the hospitals, the roads, the drives, every spare bit of ground everywhere has glyphosate sprayed on it. Okay? Now, currently, glyphosate is up for its renewal license in both in Europe and the USA. It has to have a 10-year reapproval. And currently, the country that deals with that is Germany, traditionally. And there is a governmental organisation called BFR who do the reassessment of glyphosate. And they've been doing that over the last 2 years and have supposedly taken on board all the relevant literature, published articles and stuff, that brings them to the conclusion that they have guaranteed glyphosate as being safe and that it ought to be renewed by the European Parliament. Right, so now, that is in direct contravention of what happened about five, six months ago. Yeah, yeah. The World Health Organization have had 20 experts working on it for the last 2 years, and they've come up with a conclusion that glyphosate be listed as a class 2 carcinogen. So this is in direct challenge to what our own reapproval authority have declared. So we've got a problem, folks, a big problem. Now, 10 years ago, when glyphosate was up for reapproval in the European Union, BFR were contacted by the German government. And the German government had found out that one of the formulations of glyphosate included a surfactant stroke adjuvant, something that makes it stick to the plant, right? That is a carcinogen. It's called POAE. Righto? Now, the German government secretly contacted Monsanto, who at that time still had the patent on Roundup. That's run out now at the turn of the century. But anyway, they ordered Monsanto to remove that specific formulation of glyphosate from the German formula. So for the last 10 years, the German government have known full well that POAE is a carcinogen. They demanded its removal in Germany, so they've respected the rights of their citizens to be free of a carcinogen. The problem was, they didn't tell anyone else in Europe about this. So for the last 10 years, the formulation of glyphosate that has been used in this country, 92% of our local authorities are still using a formulation of glyphosate that includes POAE. Now, just think of the council workers, think of the children in the schools. Oh, blows your mind. Dogs, particularly. Right. So we've been trying to get together a group of people to have a nationwide ban put together. And part of that is that we need to take on the local authorities individually. So your area. Okay? Now, go see your politicians, talk to them. I was invited into my borough council meeting, a full council meeting, to give a talk on glyphosate. I wanted it banned. And I got back from Germany, and I stepped out of my front door. I looked down the street, a yellow line. I looked up the street, a yellow line. I walked to my allotment, 100 yards, and followed the yellow line, the yellow brick road, or whatever they call it. I got through the gates of the allotment, opened a yellow line all the way up to the hut, where the store where the allotment shop is and stuff. And I'd had enough, you know, and I went in the shop and I give it to them, the poor lads, I'm sorry. We got loads of particularly older growers who demand to use glyphosate. So, you know, I challenged them over it and I wanted a meeting in the Allotment Association. I wrote a letter that I have a copy of, by the way. If anybody wants leaves an email address with you, I'll send you a copy of the letter. And what I've done is I've pointed all these facts out to my local authority. And in 8 weeks, they were still refusing to admit to me that they used the most carcinogenic form of Roundup. They did in the end. 2 days after the council meeting that I was invited to give the talk to, my invitation was cancelled at the last minute because I hadn't given the council 10 days' notice of what I was going to talk about. I'd only had 7 days' notice to give to them. So anyway, fair enough. So I'm due in October at the next council meeting, which is 5 months after the original one, and the end of the spraying season, by the way. So they hoodwinked me, they pulled the wool over my eyes or whatever. But, you know, we're well prepared, we're well ready. But what they've done is they've accepted my concern and they've respected my right to demand its removal, and they've said that they're going to have a meeting to reassess its use before the October meeting. So basically, these are all people that have got children too. And what they're doing is, to keep their jobs, they're ignoring, you know, what many of us would demand, you know, that is a reaction to this, and that is that it ought to be suspended pending some safety testing. Because currently any scientist who tries to stand up with any kind of data against Roundup, you know, they're gone, I'm afraid. And we all know the power of the corporations. Now, the corporations currently have 4,000 lobbyists are permanently in Brussels, 4,000 of them, and they're chipping away, all right? So you've got political representation. See what they think about it. Get them on board. And mothers with children, you know, I wouldn't like to be these councils, you know, but if we can get this kind of movement operating, I think that we can have a lot of kind of effect. All right? So we have some of the best science in the world available. Claire Robinson from GM Watch will come along. She will do, well, please ask Claire, sorry, but she's offered service, and she is always up to date with the latest articles about the subject. Come on Twitter, follow us on Twitter, and, we're up to date on a daily basis with what's going off worldwide about this. Now, has anyone heard about Scotland last week? No, it's not really been in the mainstream media. Right, so now currently under the European opt-out principle, which is still not signed but in negotiation, then countries that don't want to grow GM can elect not to. And that's exactly what Scotland have done. So already within the UK, one of the countries is saying no way. All right? Ireland, I'm in touch with an MEP in Dublin who's demanding the same in Ireland currently. And where's Kim Rue? It's about time that the Welsh have stated all along that there's going to be no GM crops in Europe, and fair play to you. But it needs restating now this week, it really does, because what we want to try to do is to keep the pressure up. So the environment ministers are meeting on the opt-out, and they're going to be voting in October, and we need people now to complain, to contact people, to see where your MEP is. If you want information about where your MEPs have been voting on this issue, we can let you have that. You know, they might be voting for it and you don't realise it. Okay. So, right. So I will hand over to Hector now for a minute, if that's okay. Any questions? Sorry about this part.
Can I ask that people put questions into the mic, because it means that people on the cameras can hear what you're saying.
How do you overcome what I would call institutional bias, that if you're seen as like somebody on the fringe, you're outside, a little bit weird, you know? So, because as soon as you step into this forum, you're branded a bit wacky, a bit off. Have you encountered that, and how do you overcome it?
Invariably, on a daily basis. You know, anyone who stands up against the solid science of GM, you know, be prepared to be attacked, I'm afraid. But, take your time, you know what is right. And basically, they might try to confuse you with pro-science and tell you that it's safe, that we've been doing this for a million years. We haven't been. These are unstable. They are trans-species in origin. So they affect us. They insult us, in my opinion, ethically, culturally, every way that I can look at it. Sorry. Just a second.
Oh.
Going back to the glyphosate thing you were saying, is there an alternative?
There is, yes.
Something, rather than saying to the local council, stop doing this, can we ask them to do this instead?
You're looking ahead perfectly. In Nottingham, which is near where I live, The park in Nottingham, which is it's a private residential area that is autonomous. They have their own council. And they also have maintenance contracts for we control and keep the place tidy and things. And they have banned Roundup. Now, what they've done is they were doing a horticultural show, and 2 days before the show, the maintenance contractors came round and sprayed everything with Roundup. Lots of dogs, one dog died. The police refused to go into the area themselves. The police did. So what do they know that we don't? Well, maybe they know something we know already anyway. But so what they've done now is they've implemented a ban and as yet haven't replaced it with anything. And that was, that you know, lots of the children in the area were having breathing difficulties around the times of the spraying and for a long time after it. And, you know, people were drawing conclusions from that. And lacking the scientific evidence they felt they needed, although the WHO had said it was a carcinogen and stuff. So now we're trying to organise together. I'm a borough council outside of there. They're Nottingham City. We're trying to take on the city councils and the county councils, which need to be taken on too. So I was talking to a lady before I came in, and she was telling me about what she's doing herself in her local authority, and they've managed to successfully get a ban from the local government. So you can do it. And, you know, anyone who wants to put on a workshop, we can get somebody from to your area, hopefully.
Yeah, go on. No, it's a very good question. It's the best and it's the most awkward question. And because at the end, you're quite right. Monsanto have got a monopoly now. And Roundup is the only herbicide out there. And it does work. But obviously, Jim's given you the reasons why we shouldn't do it. But there are alternatives. I mean, we live at a community in Takeley Park in North Devon. Let's lift that one up a little bit. And yeah, there's about sort of 26 of us there. Now, it's quite easy for us. Because like, we just do like the hippie weeding day. We all get together and we select an area and we go out and we power weed. But we're experimenting with all sorts of things. A lady called Jenny there, who does the permaculture garden. And we've actually been voted by two experts recently as having the best permaculture garden in the country, something I never knew. But that's nothing to do with me. This wonderful lady, Jenny, who knows all about companion planting. And she's experimenting with... Sam, how are you doing, mate? All right, good to see you. And she's basically experimenting with all sorts of things like cider vinegar, citronella, salt, mixtures of stuff. If we sort of like just come up with the right thing, we're going to paint it and call it Strictly Roots. That's the idea anyway. But it does actually sort of like work on a hot day, for example. If you put it on when it's sort of like overcast, this is our experience. So it's not as efficient as Roundup. The thing is to make it cheap, but we will, you know, if you want to give us your email, we'll exchange emails after this, but we're working on it. There's also flame guns. We've got a flame gun. Now, they're very, very effective. You just go over the ground, just like, you know, and that does get down into the roots. Likewise, boiling water. If you sort of like have a kettle and you sort of like don't use it, all the water's going to go cold, go outside your back door and put the boiling water just between the cracks and everything like that. All these things do make a difference. But I know when it comes to sort of like big agribusiness and things like that, they're not going to go around with the cattle and all the rest of it, go through the fields and everything. So that's why we're trying to look at alternative things. But at the end of the day, there is the alternative. And I think it's really important to bring this. I mentioned the permaculture garden. We've basically got four layers of food in our permaculture garden, like most people have. You know, we have the tree layer, the apple trees, the plums, and the sea buckthorn, which has like just got amazing sort of like vitamin C in it. Underneath that, you plant your shrub layer, and where you have your sort of like your blackcurrant bushes, your gooseberries and things like that. And the secret is that you do it in small little plots, because if you go to a kitchen garden, you see these swathes of like blackcurrants, and the birds come zoom. Once the word gets around the blackbird community, then you've had it. But we allow the sting nettles to grow through it. And so basically when we want to harvest it, we just cut the stingers down. And I think like a lot of us here, we had some amazing blackcurrants this year, the best year ever for blackcurrants. They all agree with that. And then we have the ground cover layer, and so we've basically got like perennial salads all over the ground, so you can pretty much all edible, and then you can plant your root vegetables through there. So you've got four layers of food, it's minimal dig, and the whole idea is a self-perpetuating thing. Now, I've recently written yet another letter to David Cameron saying that how I would like to see agriculture go, it's all landowners, of which I'm one, who have land around towns, cities and villages be given tax breaks to give up their land to local communities. And so people who are sort of like not working, who are unemployed, they can go out and work that land. They can earn a few extra quid a week. They're allowed to take home sort of like their own fresh vegetables and things like that. And I know it's radical, but we need to start thinking in terms of radical change. They did it in Cuba, and look at the results there. There's more than 1 million tons of of fresh vegetables there produced each year. And the health of the nation has gone up exponentially. Take the pressure off the NHS, blah, 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 and everything like that. So, sorry, that was the answer to your question. So,
Yeah, that lady that talked about the alternatives and in terms of the ban, because I think it's a multi-pronged approach. I think Hector's absolutely right in terms of start at the back door and in terms of permaculture. And, in terms of the local councils, I'm really with Jim on that. But the other thing that concerns me as well is that Roundup's routinely sprayed on crops before they're harvested. So if we're buying non-organic bread, our wheat's contaminated, our biscuits are contaminated. And I'm particularly interested in how we go forward with the NFU, with other farmers' unions in terms of major crop production. So I see it very much as a two-pronged attack. And when I began the process of talking to my local council about having a ban, the first thing I did was turn up at the town meeting. And instead of taking up anybody's time, I asked everybody that was in the room to raise their hands if they did not want glyphosate sprayed in their town. And I asked the elected members to turn around and look at them. Job done, 45 seconds. Quick and easy, very straightforward. Anybody could do that. The next thing that I did was I compiled a document which had a two-page summary of all the reasons we didn't want glyphosate, the potential toxic impacts, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, the carcinogenic elements, and a list of countries and districts that had already banned glyphosate. So in particular, we've got sort of most recently the Netherlands, we've got Bermuda. It's like the countries and the areas that are banning are coming up and up. And I think that helped my local council feel they were not alone. And then I wrote up a list of bullet points of what they could do as alternatives, working towards a ban, because I sometimes think that particularly in this country and in more rural areas, we're very slow in local government. They need to take things one thing at a time. They're incredibly under-resourced. So by making it easy, making it simple, and giving them suggestions towards alternatives, I think that made a real difference. And then we also had community weeding. We've had community weeding up on Glastonbury Tor. And I started with my town council. That's moving to the district council. And from there, we'll take it forward. And then hopefully we can bring in the highways agency, for instance. So, yeah, if anybody wants a copy of my document, unfortunately, it's 30 pages. But it's got the summary at the beginning, which is the bit that you can print out and give to your councillor.
Thanks for letting me take over.
Thank you. Thanks for brilliant input. Thank you very much. There are a number of issues. Currently, there are many more countries maybe than people realise are banning glyphosate. And lots of states, there are cities, Amsterdam, Paris have banned it. And France has stopped allowing the sale of glyphosate in garden centres. And that ban is being implemented also in Holland too soon, right? So there was a lady from Ireland sent me a photograph recently of the checkout at her local Tesco. And there were children's sweets here, and there were glyphosate bottles here right next to them. So you've got a long way to go in terms of helping people to realise it's an uphill climb, but it's doable, it really is. And If you're thinking of any direct action potential there's got to be lots of places, hasn't there, really, and things. And they're doing it regularly now in France and Belgium and Germany too, particularly. So Germany now are implementing a nationwide glyphosate ban too. And so there are lots of things that can be done. Okay.
I'm going to pass you on to Sarah now, who's been helping Matt enormously over this last sort of, like, couple of years in the fight. We've done endless like demonstrations, nationwide ones and ones outside Westminster and everything like that against it. And anyway, Sarah.
A bit embarrassed. Yeah, I'm Sarah. I'm a cook.
A cow,
but I'm a chef, cook, artist, gardener. Yeah, just to go back to the point of the lady with the suggestion for the local councils, if you are a bit of a gardener or you like to do anything like that, you could actually put yourselves forward to help redesign the parks and local areas so that you could have areas of wildflowers growing, or you could have areas that could be strimmed regularly instead of being sprayed. All of these things could be, it's just an actual whole complete different approach to the way they set up the parks, and it could be bee friendly, it could be edible, all these kinds of things, and suggesting those to the councils rather than a load of pansies, which is normally what you see in a park, would probably be a much better suggestion. But yeah, we are trying to develop Strictly Roots, but when we get there we'll tell you about it. Okay, so a little bit about glyphosate and animal feed. Okay, so in Argentina, they did some tests. I'll start from the top. Like, earlier this year, we went to a talk in London, at the University College London, by a guy called Michael Antonio, who's a molecular geneticist. And he worked for 6 years with Dr. Cerellini, who released lots of information about GM and the effect of glyphosate on rats. And we got a lot of really good information from him, and he's been doing lots of tests, and he's got first-hand information. They've tried to publish it in scientific journals, and they've been refused and refused and refused for obvious reasons. But we were lucky enough to get a lot of that information. One of the things that he said was that some of the tests done on the soya that is grown in Argentina has at least 5 times the safe level of glyphosate. Okay, now what's happening with that soya is it's getting sent across the globe, all over the place, and there's lots of it in Europe, and lots of it's going into food and into animal feed. So you can pretty much guarantee that if it's non-organic, your beef, your pork, chicken, all other poultry is going to be fed GM grain and soya, and that's going to not only have its bad health effects because it's genetically modified, but also really high toxic levels of pesticides that you really don't want to be eating. Because we touched upon the wheat, didn't we? You know, it's in a lot of our bread and all that kind of thing. So if you're going to go to the supermarket and buy meat, dairy and grains, make sure you go organic, because otherwise it's going to be highly contaminated. Another side that I'm going to talk about is more of a positive side. So what you can do to kind of help yourself and help your life. So what we've been doing, we live in North Devon, is we're trying to, well, we've got a sustainable community of people, and we're trying to branch out to the local community around us. So we've spoken to the local primary school, talking to them about growing their own vegetables, because they now create their own school lunches. So if we can help them and sort of pass on our knowledge about organic growing, and anything that you have like that you can do with your local community would be great. As well as we're also working with a really, really good planner who works on eco buildings and creating like little eco villages up and down the country, and a few other people who are kind of trying to sort out funding. And what we're going to do in Devon, hopefully, is create a network of eco sort of villages, but only small clusters. And if you're thinking about doing something like that, like a radical change, like trying to like maybe build your own house, build your own community of people where you can grow your own food, all that kind of stuff, keep your own animals, then you know where your food is coming from. And it's about passing that knowledge on, because I think what happens with communities now is we're so fragmented, you sort of go into your house and you don't even want to talk to your neighbour, you don't even want to know who lives across the road. And I think trying to have that olive branch and branching out to the people you know and talking about the knowledge and thinking, right, well, I can grow this in my garden and you can grow that in your garden, and then we can swap or we can meet up, you can organise like town swaps of things that you make and grow and all this kind of stuff. And I think anything like that would be a really good sort of network of roots to try and help change the way everybody thinks in this country, their approach to food and the importance of having it fresh and local and just know where your food comes from. But yeah, anyway, I'm going to go on
and on about it. No, that's fine. It's downhill after that. Thanks, Sarah. Yeah, I just wanted to say something that caught my eye. And this is like this, I don't know if anyone's mentioned this, but I was looking at this last night. At about sort of like 2 o'clock in the morning, and it's from Tony Benn. And Tony Benn, sort of like, I was brought up in a Tory family, and I remember my dad, when I was like a kid, being really scared of Tony Benn, because he was like, he was incredibly intelligent and everything like that, and my dad felt threatened by him. And anyway, it's funny how he sort of came around, because a few months before he died, he came and visited us at Tapley. And anyway, sort of like took him up first of all to the Pikey site at the top, and I think it was like these caravans, these trucks and everything like that. And anyway, and then there was this real hippie truck, and in it there was like, basically had a cup of tea with sort of like with a lovely sort of like girl up there for first of all. And then suddenly, as you're going around the corner, along came this guy with like literally bones in his ears and nose and everything like that, and with a sort of sack of big issues. It's like, hi, Tony, it's all I want, a big issue, no, don't have to pay and all the rest of it. Do you want a cup of tea and everything? Anyway, Tony just had a cup of tea and he just like loved meeting this guy. He was called Fluffy Mark, and sadly he's passed on because he did drink too much at the time. But really, really, he was the most successful big issue vendor in the country. Showed him the rest of the place, and Tony wrote in his book, he said, to Hector, demonstrating precisely how people should live in houses such as this. And I just thought that was such a nice thing to come back round from my childhood. I think I just thought I'd mention that. But I mentioned it in lieu of this, because this is Tony Benn, 2025-14. I love it. It's the same each time with progress. First they ignore you, then they say you're mad, then dangerous, then there's a pause, and then you can't find anyone who disagrees with you. And I just hope to pray, God bless Tony Benn's soul, I just hope to play and pray that that is what is going to happen with us. And I do believe, it seems like the odds are really, really strongly stacked against us at the moment, but there's all manners of way. And the one thing that we haven't touched on at the moment is direct action. Now, direct action is something that I believe in more than anything, and I've done an awful lot of direct actions. It really does make a big difference. I was the one who got into Rothamsted Research Centre, for example, 3 years ago, where I vandalised the wheat trial there. They were basically putting a cow gene into a wheat plant to repel aphids, and pulled a lot of crops and scattered a lot of organic wheat seed in it, and got into an awful lot of trouble, I must admit. In fact, there was a lady called Liz Snook, who was a very well-known activist, probably our sort of top activist for many, many years. Scale buildings, hand banners, there's nothing she couldn't do. And she sort of like, she arranged to meet me at Tiverton Parkway station because she needed to have a sort of like word in my ear. She got there, at the same time I got there, there was a police car and it was empty, the station. I thought, we had never seen a police car in Tiverton Parkway before. And anyway, so out the police got, they were looking behind me. I went up there and there she was in the corner. I said, I don't know about you, but I smell bacon. I said, can we go somewhere else? And she said, yeah, yeah. So anyway, and on the way out, there was another two police cars. And obviously, we all know our phones are tapped and everything like that, but it couldn't have been more obvious, you know. They sent three police cars come to basically keep an eye on two people having a conversation. One of my other favourite ones, actually, was like, last year I was going down, I had a pet goose called Christmas, and I decided that Christmas needed a friend, so we decided to go and get some ducks from Hadley Market, which is about half an hour away. And anyway, I was speaking to this friend of mine on the phone and everything like that. And she happened to be part of ALF, the Animal Liberation Front, in the mid-90s. We all know that those people have really kept a close eye on and everything like that. Anyway, it's all like my darling goose definitely needed some company. So we're on the way down. 5 minutes before we got there, she got a telephone call. And she was in the car behind. We had all these cages for the duck. She said, you know, believe it, the police just called me. They said, they asked me, should we send a police car down to Hatherley Market? Because we're wondering what you and Hector and Christie are going to do to all the animals in the cages. And I promise it's true. This just shows how much this is what happens when you do start doing this sort of thing. But it's, most of it's totally bloody ludicrous. And anyway, she said, well, what do you expect us to do? I mean, there's going to be 2,000 farmers there. If we go round and start opening up cages, we're dead, you know? And we're getting, the for our pets and everything like that. But I think it's really important to feel bold. And it doesn't matter how big or small you want to do it. It's just feel, you can feel it in your heart when it comes to direct action. You know what's right for you. I mean, for example, you can just stand outside a supermarket with a banner saying Syngenta, Monsanto, we don't want your GMOs. It doesn't matter. Writing letters to the council, your councils, I think is one of the most effective things we can do. And it is a form of direct action. Now, on the floor here, we've got all sorts of information sheets. So please come and help yourself, including the ones about the rats, which Sarah mentioned, which is the work of Dr. Serolini. But to give you this, the thing about Serolini, he was the first person to do any trials on animals over a two-year period. And he did it in secret at Caen University in the south of France. He published his results and everything, and he found up to 80% of the rats got really nasty tumours. Sarah, do you want to pass those round, actually? I know they're pretty horrific, but it's important for people to see them and have them, you know. Basically, up to 80% of these rats in the tumours, and also from the rats traced with just traces of Roundup in it as well. So that's even separate from the GM. And that's why what Jim was saying about it is in women's breast milk, it's in urine and things like that. This is serious stuff. And I'm afraid we have to start picking up our sword in whatever way and actually getting out there and bloody well doing something about it. You know, I'm really serious about that because I just can't see how else it's actually going to work. Funnily enough, just as a reference to this shirt, I'm wearing this shirt.
Hector, there's a question if you want to take it.
Oh, God, yes, please. Yeah. Shut me up for a minute.
Hi. I have noticed that quite a few of my friends' pets have had horrible tumours and died, cats and dogs. And I've just noticed it seems to be getting more common. You know, and I've always thought it was to do with the crap food, the feed, and that's got GM in and shit. You know,
it would have glyphosate. No, that's a really good point. And actually, that's the best point of the meeting so far. If we can sort of go to people and let dog owners know that their dogs are getting killed, they don't worry about the children so much. It's the dogs. That's the way this country works. So you target the dog owners. I think that's a really, really, really good point. So, and for them, yeah, Jim's going to have a little chat.
A bit more about glyphosate being used pre-harvest. You mentioned it, yeah. Well, this last week now, Germany, northern province in Germany, has banned the use of glyphosate as a desiccant also. Yeah. All right? And also... does anybody know about the neonicotinoid situation with the bees and things? Yeah. Is there? I wasn't aware of that. Yeah. Well, there is a European-wide ban on the use of neonicotinoids on any flowering species of plants and things, right? So on oilseed rape... last year, they weren't allowed to use it anywhere in the UK on oilseed rape crops. So now what happened was, Patterson, you remember the name? He tried to get a derogation for 500,000 acres of neonic-treated oilseed rape to be grown, and it was thrown out, and he lost his job about a week afterwards, by the way. And now the new trust, the new environment minister, has secretly... Well, what happened was she put in... a derogation application for 100,000 acres to be grown of oilseed rape in the UK. And it was refused about a month ago. And then what they did, they pulled a fast one. They secretly had a second meeting and put in an application for 20,000 acres, inviting Syngenta and Monsanto to the meeting and keeping the minutes of the meeting secret, which is against the law, right? But imagine inviting the company that are of interest to the awarding of the contract. Ridiculous. So we've currently got a derogation in operation for 20,000 acres of oilseed rape to be grown in 4 counties in the UK come September. It's winter oilseed rape that's going to go in the ground. Now, 5,000 letters of complaint were registered in Cambridge.
Jim, can we just... I think the question was which counties?
Which counties are the four? I know Cambridge is one. I believe Norfolk is another one. But you'll have to check the rest. I'm sorry. My head's a bit... So anyway, so the challenge only has to be on four counties. So that cuts it down a hell of a lot in terms of being able to get... a concentration of effort in the different counties. All right. Now, also, it needs to be pointed out that all Monsanto's herbicide-tolerant and BT crops are neonic-treated. So in order for them to get a commercial release as in this country, they've got to reverse the neonic ban. So what you can be sure of, it's nothing to do with genetic engineering per se, but... All the things are so interlinked that they're incestuous. They really are. And so they've got lots of weaknesses in lots of different places. So you can be sure that there's going to be massive lobbying pressure, both here and in Europe, to get neonics reversed. So if everybody's worried that we're going to get commercial releases in a month's time, we're not. We're stuck head-to-head with them. The opt-out principle that was agreed on last year, now the countries that have made the agreements are starting to have second thoughts about it. And they're wobbling about the whole thing because they're realizing that even though countries elect to be GM-free, that once TTIP is signed, there's going to be no protection mechanism. What will happen is the ISDS, which is the complaints mechanism, without challenge, can bring in the interests of American goods and services wherever they're restricted. So even though big countries like Germany and France are fully intent on banning GM, and they will more than likely succeed in it, they're going to have to pay. Because under ISDS, whatever these companies lose out on, they have to be compensated for. So they're going to tax you to be GM-free. That's what it's going to sort of result in.
Monsanto have noticed that quite a lot of us are not keen on this glyphosate rubbish.
Yeah.
And they're not stupid, so they've caught on and they have nearly released a replacement for Roundup. So we need to watch out for that too.
Well, I don't know about that, I'm afraid. And also, neonicotinoids, with this derogation, it's a propaganda thing, this is. They're desperate to get neonics here, even more desperate than GM crops, because they know they can't have one without the other. Okay, so if you want to support the beekeepers, you know, and also, in Germany are going even more radically against neonics because winter wheat now is going to be banned this year as neonic treated in Germany. So, you know, we're supposed to be in the European Union. What's good for one country should be good for all of us. Why is it that Germany are able to implement a ban and we're able to remove the ban with a derogation? The four counties for neonics: Suffolk, Cambridge, Bedford, and Hertfordshire. Or is it Hertfordshire? Hertfordshire. Thank you very much. So they're the four counties, and by all means, target those places. Okay. Right. Thank you. Bravo.
As I said, you know, we've got all this stuff on the floor, but recently we were up at Dr. Antonio's talk up in London. We got given these graphs. He got showed these graphs, and these are fascinating because you can pick up copies of this on the floor. It's basically 1996 when GM was given the green light and obviously saw, like, you know, extra use doses of like glyphosate. 1996. The incidence of glyphosate resistant weeds and super weeds goes up like that. Can you just hold that? Sorry, the next page is like deaths from senile dementia. Again, deaths go up exponentially in 1996. The one over the page, deaths from Alzheimer's disease. Again, that's 1996. You can pick these up and see for yourself. This is sick reading, but this is the truth. Deaths from Parkinson's disease. You know, all the same thing. So that's why we just have to do something. Funny enough, like this shirt that I'm wearing sort of like a, as a dedication to Gerald Miles, who sadly couldn't be here today, but we all say Jim actually has got more in his mouth than any of us actually about it. This was given to us by a German activist where we went out there about 3 years ago to do a direct action on the first genetically modified field of potatoes. And I was going to be the runner because I could run quite fast. So I was put in the wrong wood and everything like that. It was pouring with rain. But luckily I was dressed as a genetically modified potato. And that came in extra useful because when I was like running through the field, obviously I was soaked to the bones, and this guy called Jürgen sort of called it off because he was so furious I was late and got lost in the maize field. And then I thought, stop this. And anyway, I went around the corner, and there was all the sort of like the German protesters, and there was only about 20 of them, and lots of riot police. And anyway, I was the only one to get arrested there, and I got hurled into the back of this riot van, sort of bumped around. But when you're dressed as a genetically modified potato, it really didn't hurt at all, bashed it and everything like that. So, huge advice, actually, when you go do direct actions, is to dress up. And anyway, so like we were all given these shirts, but that's what I'd like to recommend. But as I said, sorry, would you like to say a few words now? Like a rabbit on and on and on. Oh yeah, oh God, if we could jag your email addresses. So I was going to have two of them around, and then we'll keep you up to date about everything. And that's be really important. And as I said, you know, take as many of these and get them out to as many other people as possible. I mean, write to councils and everything like that. Is anyone from Totnes here by any chance? Anyone from Totnes? No, I'm quite keen to meet up with some Totnes activists, actually. Anyway, Jim's going to get on.
The Twitter site that we're on from Jen is at Jen Eng Network. Please follow us, and it's up to the minute, and any input, if you tweet us, if you want to learn how to tweet, you know, it really is the format of choice at the moment, it really is. Okay. Big G, capital G-E-N, big E-N-G, lowercase, and then big N, capital N, big N, and then the rest of the word network. Okay, everyone. And please, contribute. And
is it too late for the last question here?
Not
I'd like to go back to Denmark and send to my network in New Zealand, who I'm from. I have a question.
Right.
Sorry about that. It's actually... The microphone is really for people outside.
Is the Minister of Education here?
I presume not.
Is the Minister of Energy? Do you have a Minister of Energy here in this island?
Supposedly.
Any local politicians here?
I don't think he goes to work for
with the family. Anyway, isn't it Sunday? They might have been to church. But is there any here, local politicians? Good. I'll tell you what. If they could see this, how clean they people are here. These are not mainstream consumers here. We care about our Mother Earth. Where are the politicians, local politicians, with their children or their mates, drinking tea or coffee, and thinking about children?
To be fair, we did have some local politicians here yesterday. Molly Scott Cato was here. Jenny Jones, we've had. Shane,
we've
of course.
Had a few politicians, but they're not at this here and now.
Well, this is so important.
It is. Right then. Most definitely. Yeah, so I'll talk a bit more about the neonic ban if I could. So the derogation has gone through for 20,000 acres. There continues to be lots and lots of data coming up on a virtually daily basis about the negative impacts of neonicotinoids. And I learned the other day there's actually traces now in all our food of neonicotinoids. Okay, so that's a really big issue that the food campaigners haven't even thought about, really. And when you think that all the herbicide-tolerant BT, everything Monsanto produces is neonic-treated. So they basically have to buy Syngenta because Syngenta produces the neonic-treated seed. Okay, right.
I just thought I'd tell everybody that if you listen to Radio 4 quite early in the morning at 4:45, there's a farming programme, and you get to hear all this stuff weeks and months before it's out in the general news. And I heard about the neonicotinoids being, the seeds are coated in them, and then they've discovered that they're actually still there, the neonicotinoid chemicals are still there in the soil three years after the initial seed was put in.
Lovely.
And
neonic chemical treatment on one seed to kill 40,000 bees. One seed. Honestly. I mean, you know, it might be challenged that how are bees going to turn around and eat a seed? No, but every part of that plant, from the moment that it sprouts to the moment it's harvested, any part of that plant that is consumed by any creature dies as a result of it. That's how deadly that poison is. Neonicotinoids. All the GM, all the herbicide-tolerant crops are neonic-treated. All the BT crops are herbicide-treated. That are grown everywhere in the world. So Monsanto cannot get herbicide commercial releases in the UK unless the neonic ban is reversed.
I just meant like any of my local seeds.
Your garden centres have it on them. It's purple. So look for your seed. There are often fungal treatments on them, but if they're purple, don't go near them. Buy organic and grow your own. Save your own seed. Even better, and then you're not dependent on anyone. Okay.
When we're talking about it getting into animal feed and things, is it also getting through the manure and onto our crops, or is it strictly in the tissue of the animal?
It's in everything, and you know, there's a massive class action lawsuit against glyphosate in the US because they've stated for years that it's environmentally friendly, and that it doesn't remain active for more than 24 hours. Now it's been proven it's still active 3 months later now, and it's in every form of food production apart from the organic food system is completely riddled with it everywhere. And also about the loaves of bread where the desiccant is used pre-harvest. It breaks down the fibre of the plant to make harvesting easier. So it's more financially rewarding, right? 2 days before. Peter of... his name now. The former leader of Greenpeace has written to all the supermarkets restating that to continue the use of glyphosate as a desiccant, right, is exposing the populace now to a known carcinogen, which up until this point, without the WTO declaration, we weren't able to say. Peter Melcher, he's written as... the leader of the organic movement in the UK and former leader of Greenpeace, has written to all the supermarkets to restate the case that if they allow their supermarkets to continue to use neonic wheats and stuff like that and glyphosate, that they're exposing their population to carcinogens.
Jim,
we can.
Jim, yeah. I'm afraid we're out of time. Hector, I don't know if you had some last... You look like you might be about to leap up, but okay, so sorry, yeah, a quick roundup would be lovely.
Oh yeah, just really quickly, yeah, just a roundup. Yeah, if you want, just a roundup, sorry. Sorry, I didn't mean to say that. ground up. There's on YouTube, there's a video called Endocrination, which you might want to have a look at. And there's also something else, somebody that we know called Jason Leosartis. He has an online program called Outside the Box. And he did it really, really good. He interviews all sorts of people from all over the world. He interviewed Hector. He also interviewed a lady called Zen Honeycutt, who is from Mums Across America. And it's a really, really good interview. And she sort of tells you all about how her children had problems and then from the GM and all the rest of it. And then she switched them to an organic diet and how they improved immediately. And they all collected urine samples. And it's really, really good. If you go on to Outside the Box, you can find out loads of information. There's loads of interviews you can watch. Outside the Box. And his name's Jason Leosartis. LIASATOS.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Sarah. And thanks, Hector, Jim, and Sarah, for, I know this is an issue that's very close, very important to a lot of people.